On May 12, 2020 at 8:30 in the morning, Slack's database reliability team was alerted to a significant load increase in their database infrastructure. Tracing the traffic upstream, they found that this corresponded to a load increase in the servers in their main web app tier, which handles the bulk of Slack user requests like logging in, sending messages, and creating channels. As a result, API requests began to fail and customers began to experience sporadic errors. A quick inspection revealed that this wasn't the typical traffic spike, but the result of a buggy deployment. A configuration change had triggered a performance bug, and it was quickly rolled back. There were about 3 minutes of customer impact, and most users were still able to send messages successfully during this incident. Thanks for watching, we'll see you next time. Well, actually, this was just the calm before the storm, as indicated by the title of this postmortem. Since this was during the start of the COVID era, when everyone began to work from home and communicate electronically, Slack had configured their system to autoscale much more quickly than before to meet the demand. This means that extra web app and database instances would automatically launch when certain thresholds are hit. And speaking of databases, that brings us to today's sponsor, Neon Postgres. You may have heard of Postgres, a feature-loaded database used by your favorite companies. But before you install Postgres to build your to-do list as a service startup, you always have the option for the pros and Neon to host it for you, instantly provisioning your database in the cloud for lightning-fast queries that scale to any use case. Developers will be glad to know that Neon's branching feature allows everyone to have their own isolated branch for local development. Even the AI agents are happy, as Neon's speedy provisioning and scale to zero means bots can blow through ephemeral testing databases like nobody's business. Whether you're a developer, database admin, or just bored, visit neon.tech and get the free plan to experience the features of tomorrow available today. So Slack's overenthusiastic auto-scaling, compounded with the load increase caused by the configuration error, triggered the system to increase their web app instance count by either 75 or 80%, depending on which postmortem you read, reaching an all-time high. This wasn't actually that concerning though, as temporarily over-provisioning the host, if anything, should safeguard against traffic-related outages. In fact, manually going into prod to scale everything back down would be an unnecessary risk. What if someone accidentally types in the wrong number and blows everything up? Therefore, it would make the most sense to simply wait until the end of the business day, when traffic would calm down and the system would automatically scale back in. So everyone continued to go about their day for the next 8 hours until they received an alert that Slack was serving more HTTP 503 errors than normal. This particular error code means a server cannot handle requests due to being overloaded or down for maintenance. Slack should never be down for maintenance, barring an advance electronic notice or act of God. So its web app instances must have been overloaded. And overloaded they were, as from 4:45 p.m. onwards, users were no longer able to connect to Slack. It was a complete outage. Disgruntled remote workers on the West Coast were now presented with a tantalizing opportunity to try and get to Costco before rush hour, but they would all end up stuck in a massive line anyways because everyone else had the same idea. Back at Slack, the engineers realized that this was a Severity 1 issue and made sure to page the CEO. They couldn't discuss the issue on Slack since Slack was down, so they spun up an incident response Zoom call. And the on-call engineer for the web app tier made the obvious move in response to traffic overload, which was to scale out the web app fleet. This, however, did not help at all. They noticed that a subset of the fleet was under heavy load, while the rest of the web app instances, including the ones they just launched, had very little load, if any. This immediately made it clear that the main problem was not with the web app instances themselves, but the upstream proxy which distributes requests to these servers. For some reason, the load was not being balanced evenly. The sus upstream load balancing service in question here were the servers running HAProxy, a free and open source load balancer and proxy named after its high availability. Fortunately for the FOSSing community, it was not the FOSS that was at fault here, but Slack's usage of it. Specifically, the way they gave HAProxy the target group of web app instances to distribute the requests to. You may recall from the previous Roblox video a service discovery software from HashiCorp called Console. This is also what Slack used to keep track of their web app instances. As new instances are launched, Console ensures they pass basic health checks and registers their IPs to its service registry. Then the service registry, which you can think of as a constantly changing list of IPs, somehow needs to be continually communicated to HAProxy. How did they do this? I hacked into the Slack archives and procured a copy of the design review of this component. Let's take a look. Anyone here? Anyone? Sorry, I was on mute. Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, we're all here.
Okay, sorry for getting you all together after work hours, but maybe you can all eat up this design for dinner or something. Okay, so this will be quick. This is just a small design thing here. I want to decide on the best way for HAProxy to get the web app servers from console. The most straightforward way is to use console's built-in DNS interface. We can configure HAProxy to query console for IP addresses through these built-in config directives. What do you all think? Sorry, it got paged. Dropping. Looks like a pretty big one. And that sounds good, but DNS TCL will add some lag. And I think we have run into issues in the past with very large DNS responses since our target groups will be pretty big. If you stress test this and it works out, though, I'm fine with it. Cool. Another way is to get the IPs with the console API and update the HAProxy config file. Then we can reload HAProxy so it gets the latest config. This will be a graceful reload, which will automatically keep the old one alive while it works on in-flight requests. We can do this with a background task. What do you all think? That sounds good, but I see a few issues here. The process may be held up by long-lived requests and results in many HAProxy processes running simultaneously, which will no doubt consume significant CPU and memory. Furthermore, our philosophy here is to auto-scale the web tier very flexibly, so this would mean the list of IPs probably changes a lot, and therefore HAProxy will reload a lot, which is not necessarily a good thing. But, you know, I can see this one working out too. So the last way I have is to instead use the HAProxy runtime API to dynamically configure the target IPs. This is the same concept as the previous one, except our background task will be adding the IPs using the runtime API. So this way HAProxy remains running the whole time.
That sounds good, but it does not provide us with as much flexibility as the previous options, since not all configuration changes are doable with API. You know, I'm not that familiar with the runtime API, but this seems potentially complex and bug-prone. I don't know, though. If you think it's good, you should just go ahead with it.
So which of the three do you think is the best?
They all look good to me.
But I need to start implementing this tonight, or else I'm not going to make the deadline.
I see. The final say is going to be with Bill, though, since he's the tech lead for this project. It looks like he dropped the call earlier for a page, though.
So what am I supposed to do?
Not sure. Well, anyways, all seems good, but my dog wants to be walked, so I'll be signing off later.
In the end, Slack implemented the last option, make a background task which calls the HAProxy runtime API to update the server list dynamically. This is what server state management does in this diagram from Slack. It consumes data from console template, which is a pre-built application that comes with console, which outputs the web app instance IPs. Then it calls HAProxy's API to update the server list represented by these slots. Slack configured HAProxy to have N slots, meaning that HAProxy can only forward traffic to a maximum of N web app instances at a time. N was just a somewhat arbitrary limit they had set at some point, which they knew was safe, and they figured would take a while to hit. So normally, the instance count would be far lower than N, and there would be plenty of headroom. However, after the 80% auto-scaling increase caused by the configuration error that morning, the web app tier scaled to higher than N, filling all the available slots. As a result, like a game of musical chairs, some of the web app instances were left without a seat. The existence of these orphaned instances was not that big of a deal, just a suboptimal allocation of resources that needs to be corrected. The more concerning part was what happened due to all N HAProxy spots being used. This was the first time this has ever happened, and a far more nefarious bug was about to unearth itself. To understand this bug, we must understand the code that updates HAProxy slots, which can be found in server state management. We have four helper methods here: getting the server list from console, getting the servers in the HAProxy slots,
adding a server to HAProxy, and removing a server from HAProxy. The dumbest way you can implement this logic is to loop through all the servers currently in HAProxy, remove all of them, and then add all the new servers from console like so. This will result in you taking down the company every time the script is run, as at some point in time, all the slots will be empty. To work around this, Slack simply first added all the newly launched instances, and then removed all the instances that no longer existed, represented by servers in the HAProxy list that were not in the console list. This looks fine, but here was the catch. The add server to HAProxy method will fail if there are no available slots. Do you see the issue? Exactly. Because the slots were currently full, the script will fail at the add part and never even get to the cleanup section. Every time server state management executed, it immediately failed to add the new instances and the HAProxy slots remained unchanged. As the day continued and web app instances continued to be naturally replaced, whether through scaling in, updates, deployments, or hardware failure, the HAProxy slots began to point to non-existent IPs and become more and more out of sync with reality. By the end of the day, traffic had calmed down, so the web app tier had scaled in enough so that the majority of slots in HAProxy were non-existent IPs and the only valid targets were the few instances that had been up since the morning. Traffic was thus concentrated on these instances, overloading them, and causing the issue we saw before. Now that the engineers knew what was going on, they resolved the issue quickly with a rolling restart of the HAProxy instances, which would empty out the spots and fill them with IPs that actually exist. After the incident was mitigated, the first question they asked themselves was why their monitoring didn't catch this problem. They had alerting in place for this precise situation, but unfortunately, it wasn't working as intended for two classic reasons. One, the system had always just worked, so no one could tell it was broken. And two, the system was scheduled to be replaced in the future, so there was little point in improving the existing one anyways, especially in something as useless as monitoring. This bug appears to be something a simple load test should have easily caught in a pre-prod environment. But it's possible that reaching end slots required a legitimately insane amount of traffic that was only possible by the first configuration bug. As for the code here, Slack's short-term fix could have been to make the slot addition failure not cause an early exit or flip the order to clean up first. In the long term though, they had put HAProxy on the chopping block and now use Envoy Proxy for ingress traffic. HAProxy had served Slack well and reliably for many years, but it was time to move on. Cheers to all the engineers that worked hard on the original system. Hey, wait a second, I need help. I don't want to pull another all-nighter. Please.